Hello, everyone, and welcome to lesson number four. Today we're going to do a word of the day, we're going to do a sentence study, and then we are going to read a poem because it is Tuesday. We're going to read Hope is the Thing with Feathers by Emily Dickinson. I don't know about you, but before we isolated ourselves at home, whenever we were out at the grocery store, did anyone else besides me look around and actually wonder what 6 feet actually looked like? I would take steps to see what 6 feet. I would picture things that I know that 6 feet high or long. And I would, try to see exactly what 6 feet was like. So I found this article on CNN, social distancing means standing 6 feet apart. Here's what that actually looks like. So I found our sentence study from this article. I got our word from this article. And then they have some funny pictures down here. So we're gonna go over those as well. The word of the day is congregate or congregate. So congregate is the verb, which means to gather in a large crowd. And then congregate is the adjective, which resembles a crowd. Okay, so it's the same word for the most part, just pronounced differently. But it's the pronunciation of it depends on the situation in which you use it. So just a reminder, a verb is an action, so to something, and then an adjective describes a noun. If you're at the grocery store and there's a long line, well, first off, stay away from that line. But if there's a long line, you would say that that is congregate. If you are invited somewhere and someone goes, "Come on, everyone, let's congregate around." First off, don't do that right now. But if they say congregate around, that means to gather in a large crowd. So if you look at this sentence, the Centers for Disease Control and Prevention describes social distancing as, quote, remaining out of the congregate or congregate. If you said congregate, good job. The Centers for Disease Control and Prevention describes social distancing as remaining, quote, remaining out of congregate settings, avoiding mass gatherings and maintaining distance approximately 6 feet or 2 meters from others when possible. All right, so a few things about this sentence before we're going to revise this sentence today. First off, whenever you put things in quotes, what this means is this, what I highlighted, that is from somewhere else. That is probably a direct quote from the CDC. This is what CNN is writing. Okay, so when you put the two together, that is what we call an embedded quote. Number two, technically, whenever you're reading something out loud, you do not have to read the things in parentheses, all right? Parentheses, what that means is it's additions or modify something else. So maintain distance, and then this modifies what the distance is from others when possible. A particular sentence is 32 words long. So for today's sentence study, I would like you to rewrite this sentence in only 16 words. Do have a caveat as well. Because the majority of this sentence is in quotations, you have to include something from these quotations, but you have to put whatever you include in quotations. Okay. You know how we do this? Please pause. All right, so welcome back. Here's my sentence in only 16 words. CDC describes social distancing as, quote, avoiding congregate settings, end quote, and staying about 6 feet away, quote, from others, end quote. So if you want to share your sentence in the comments below, go ahead. If not, you could just hang on to it, but that's fine. So before we move on to the 5 minute journal, I wanted to share some of these things with you. So again, this was the article, so social distancing means standing 6 feet apart. Here's what that actually looks like. I really wanted to show you some of these pictures because I thought they're pretty funny. So if you're finding it hard to estimate what exactly 6 feet looks like, we've got a list of animals, people, and things you can keep in mind to help you judge the appropriate distance you should keep from other people. So here we go. Two golden retrievers standing nose to tail, a man wearing a top hat, an average sedan, a sofa, a dining room table, the length of a mattress, So that's the length of full and twin size beds. Yeah, that's funny, isn't it? Sorry, my daughter thinks that's pretty funny. A moose's antlers, two adult cats, a door, and a 6 foot long bathtub. All right, so those are ideas of what 6 feet looks like. So next time you have to go out, or you know someone else knocks on your door, just picture two golden retrievers standing nose to tail, and I think you'll be okay. All right, today's 5 minute journal. The quote is, "Hope is the thing with feathers." So that's the first line of our poem that we're going to read today. So please respond to that. Today, I'm grateful for three good things. Today's affirmation, I am. And then today's prompt, if you get that far, is, "My biggest hope is..." 5 minutes on your own. You know what to do. So pause. So for today's lesson, we're going to read "Hope is the Thing with Feathers" by Emily Dickinson. So there's three steps on how to read poetry. The first step is to come up with an inference. So an inference is an educated guess based on just background knowledge that you have. Now, the key phrase of that is educated guess. All right. So after you read it the whole way through, you come up with, again, an idea as to what it's about. "Hope is the thing with feathers that perches in the soul and sings the tune without the words and never stops at all. And sweetest in the gale is heard, and sore must be the storm that could abash the little bird that kept so many warm. I've heard it in the chillest land and on the strangest sea, yet never in extremity it asked a crumb of me." Take a few seconds, get some ideas, write them down, maybe talk to your parent, guardians, brothers, sisters. What could this poem be about? You got the hiccups. You got the hiccups. Okay. Now, the second way that you read a poem is you read it line by line or stanza by stanza. Okay. So a stanza is basically, in this case, it is four lines. So a stanza is broken up with spaces, but I always explain it as a paragraph to an essay is a stanza to a poem. All right. So in this case, these are three stanzas. That's called a quatrain, but that's another lesson. All right. And it just organizes the thoughts. So they stand by themselves. So we're going to look at stanza number one. "Hope is the thing with feathers." So first off, what is hope? If you had to define hope, what would that be? Okay. And also, what has feathers? So obviously birds have feathers, and I'm a dinosaur nerd. So I know there are a lot of studies and research right now that dinosaurs actually had feathers as well. All right. So again, just keep that in mind. What is hope? What is your definition of hope? And what has feathers? "That perches in the soul." So first off, what is perches? All right. So perches is, this is a line and something just kind of chilling on there. That's called perching. All right. So now we go back to the feathers idea. What perches? Most likely birds. And then what is your definition of soul? Okay. Is it like James Brown, the soul man? Or is it the soul that you feel inside of you? I mean, there's a lot of different ways that you can look at that, but try to think of that. What is your definition of soul? "And sings the tune without the words." So sing a song without words. Go ahead. All right, so if you sing a song without words, what does that do to the song as a whole? So if you add words to a song, how does that change the meaning? Okay, so if this bird, if that's what we're going to run with, the bird sings this tune without the words, what does that do? What does that mean? The last one, "never stops at all." What do you know in your life that never stops? What's something that is continuous? It just keeps going and going and going. So now that we read the entire stanza, I want you to, again, by yourself, on the side, in your journal, write down what that stanza means in like one, two, maybe three words. "And sweetest in the gale is heard." So a gale is a very, very strong wind. It's more than a breeze, less than a storm. So it's not just, "Ooh, breeze against my face. Ooh, breeze against my face." Or it's not a storm. It's just a brisk breeze, a brisk breeze. So obviously it's loud enough that you can hear it. And sore must be the storm. So how can a storm be sore? Or how could a storm cause soreness? All right, so I just found that the other day that I think I have like tennis elbow. It's very, very sore, okay? So again, how could a storm be a sore? All right, that could abash the little bird. So abash means to embarrass someone or something. So again, how could a strong wind, a gale, embarrass a little bird? So something big embarrass something so little. Something intimidating embarrass something so innocent. That kept so many warm. So obviously this bird is important. So if something keeps you warm, it comforts you, okay? So again, do what we just did from stanza number one. Stanza number two, in your own words, one, two, maybe three words, what is this stanza about? I'm gonna get a drink of water. All right, here we go. Stanza number three. I've heard it in the chillest land. Heard what? What did the writer, in this case, Emily Dickinson, what did she hear? All right. Also chillest. So obviously we got cold, which ties back to the last stanza that kept so many warm. So obviously if it's chilly, this little bird led to the warmth. And on the strangest sea. So what are some examples of strange things? We have Stranger Things. Some outfits are strange. The Doors song, people are strange. How's that go? People are strange. People are strange. Extremity is the furthest point or limit of something. So extremity is the furthest point or limit of something. So right now, this is not an extremity. However,
this is extremity.
Because the wall was there and I had to go far away. It asked a crumb of me. What asked a crumb of me? Okay, so again, last stanza, one, two, maybe three words, put all of your thoughts together. Now, when you put it all together, there's one last thing we need to go over, and that is what a metaphor is. So a direct comparison of two objects, people, or things. Hope and a thing with feathers. What I would like you to do in the comments below, please write in one sentence, what is this poem about? So based on the three stanzas we just went over and the idea of the metaphor comparing hope to a bird, one sentence, what is this poem about? All right, and our big finish today, I actually have a poetry prompt, a little poetry assignment for you. I'm looking forward to read these. Think about everything that's going on with this coronavirus. Everyone is isolated. Everyone is told to stay home. Students, there is no school. So think about all that. Think about what's going on in society and how, what is your hope with all of this? And I would like you to write a 1 to 3 stanza poem. Now it doesn't have to rhyme. So 1 to 3, so it can be 2. So 1, 2, or 3 stanza poem, but your first line is hope is, and then in the information below, I put a link that pops up random animals, okay? So I want your first line to be, hope is a or an, and then go to this website and literally put in a random animal. So the one I just did is a fox. So my example that I'm gonna put in the comments below is hope is a fox. And then I'm gonna dedicate 1, 2, or 3 stanzas explaining what hope is in comparison to what a fox does, but the overall context to the overall coronavirus crisis. That is your assignment. I'm looking forward to reading those. And as always, enjoy yourself. People are strange.